Today, we will learn how to program a microcontroller and understand how you can program it. For this, I have a PCB available here, and you can see that there is a microcontroller installed on it. However, we cannot program this particular microcontroller because the company has locked it with a passcode, which prevents us from accessing its program. But along with it, there's another microcontroller present on the PCB. Take a look at this one. This microcontroller is programmable. We can both read and write data to it. Both actions are possible here. Now, let me show you how to program this microcontroller. Sometimes, this microcontroller may fail or malfunction. Additionally, there are three sensors connected here. This smaller microcontroller reads these sensors and communicates with the main controller via serial communication. Through this communication, it helps control the compressor's speed. If there's a fault or if the system needs to enter protection mode, this smaller microcontroller guides the main microcontroller through serial communication, and both microcontrollers work together to run the program smoothly. Now let's focus on the microcontroller installed here, which is a 20-pin STM8S103F3P6. This microcontroller is programmable, and today I'll explain in detail how to program it. First, we need to understand why we need to reprogram it. Sometimes, issues arise that require reprogramming. Let me demonstrate by turning on the PCB. As soon as I power on the PCB, you can see that two LEDs have turned on. One of them, LED1, turns on briefly and then starts giving an error signal. Meanwhile, the green LED, LED2, is directly connected to this microcontroller. If this LED is blinking, it indicates that the microcontroller is functioning properly. However, if this LED fails to blink, it could indicate a program corruption issue. In such cases, having a backup of the microcontroller's original program is crucial. Without this backup, you cannot repair the system, whether you're reprogramming the existing microcontroller or replacing it with a new one. Without the specific program, the PCB will remain non-functional. This is because the microcontroller's role is critical in reading data from the three sensors and communicating this information to the main controller. If this communication fails, the PCB won't function under any circumstances. To program this microcontroller, we need both software and hardware. I'll now explain both the software and hardware setup needed to program this microcontroller. Now I'll explain which software you need to use to program this microcontroller. After that, we'll move on to the hardware setup. First, you'll need a computer or laptop to perform the programming. Since my computer is already powered on, I'll open Chrome browser. In the search bar, type STVPSTM8 and press enter. You'll see the first website appear in the search results. Click on it. This will take you to the ST Microelectronics website. Here, you can either create an account or visit the site as a guest, but I recommend creating an account for a better experience. Next, scroll down the page, and you'll see an option labeled Get Latest. Click on it. Once you click, a license agreement will appear. Accept it to proceed. After this, you'll see two options: Create My ST Account and log into my ST. Since I already have an ST account, I'll click on login. However, if you're accessing this for the first time, you'll need to click on Create My ST, provide the required details, and successfully create a free account. Since I already have an account, I'll proceed by clicking on login. Now, once I logged in, a file automatically started downloading. Although I had previously downloaded this file, I'll demonstrate the process again for your understanding. After scrolling down the page, you'll find an option called Get Software. Here, you'll see the STVPSTM8 Visual Program. Click on the Download Latest button. Upon clicking, another license agreement will appear. Accept the agreement, and the download will begin. Wait for the download to complete. As you can see, it's downloading and has now finished. The downloaded file is in zip format. Click on the zip file, and you'll see options asking which program you'd like to use to open it. Choose File Explorer to open the file. Once opened, you'll find a folder named ST Tools Pack. Double-click this folder, and a prompt will appear stating that the publisher is unknown. Despite this, the software is trustworthy, so grant the necessary permissions by clicking Yes to proceed with the installation. As the ST toolset opens, the installation process will continue. During the installation, make sure to click Yes for every prompt or agreement that appears. Avoid clicking No. By consistently selecting Yes, the installation will complete successfully. Now it's showing a message indicating that the required page is not available. However, I'll ignore this message and simply close it. Once closed, the Welcome to the InstallShield Wizard for ST Toolset window appears. Here, click Next to proceed. Next, an agreement will appear. Accept the terms and click Next again. The installer will now show the installation location where the program will be saved on your computer. Simply click Next to proceed, but if you'd prefer to change the location, you can do so at this step. Now, select the option to create both shortcuts and click Next once again. The installation process will now begin. The installer will initialize the required drivers, and the entire program will be installed successfully. Once the installation is complete, click Finish to finalize the setup. Finally, close the installer. Now I have two programs available, ST Visual Develop and ST Visual Programmer. I'll select ST Visual Programmer. Upon double-clicking it, the interface appears. The first step here is to configure the software to specify what device we are going to program. To configure it, click on the Configure option from the menu, and then select Configure ST Visual Programmer. Next, since we are programming an STM8 microcontroller, we need to adjust the settings accordingly. The first setting to configure is the hardware. In the Configuration window, locate the Hardware section and select ST-Link. As soon as you select this, the interface will automatically change. The port should remain set to USB, and for the programming mode, select SWIM. Upon selecting SWIM, the interface will change again. Next, identify the specific device you are programming. Locate your device by selecting the model number. In this case, STM8S103F3. Click on it and keep all the settings as they are. Finally, click OK to confirm the settings. Once confirmed, the interface will update accordingly. To proceed with programming, the first step is to turn off the PCB and disconnect its power supply. It's important to wait until the LEDs on the PCB, which were previously illuminated, completely turn off before moving to the next step. This ensures that no electrical power is present during the programming process. For programming, you will need the ST-Link V2 hardware programmer. If this device is not available locally, it can be easily ordered online, as it is widely accessible. The ST-Link V2 features several labeled connections, including RST, reset, SWIM, GND ground, 3.3 volts, and 5 volts. Additionally, there are more connections and voltage labels on the opposite side of the programmer. For programming the STM8 microcontroller, you will only need to use 4 connections from the left side of the ST-Link V2, RST, SWIM, GND, and 3.3V. Since the STM8 microcontroller operates at 3.3 volts, the left side pins are identified by the corresponding numbers marked on the left side of the ST-Link V2, while the numbers on the right side correspond to the right side pins. In this setup, only the left side pins should be used for making the necessary connections. To attach the required connections, we will need some wires. These wires will be used to connect the relevant pins from the ST-Link V2 to the microcontroller. Starting from the reset pin to the 3.3V pin, we will connect each wire accordingly. On the left side of the ST-Link V2, we'll attach the connector that holds these wires in place. One important factor to keep in mind is the color coding of these wires, as this will guide the correct connections. According to the color coding, the reset pin uses a white cable, the SWIM pin uses a gray cable, the ground pin uses a purple cable, and the 3.3V pin uses a blue cable. Now, on the microcontroller itself, there are 3 pins labeled SWIM, ground, and 3.3 volts. The first pin is for SWIM, the middle pin is for ground, and the third pin is for 3.3V. Following the color code, we will connect the gray cable to the SWIM pin, the purple cable to the ground pin, and the blue cable to the 3.3 volt pin. With these 3 connectors securely attached, we now need to connect the 4th wire, which is for the reset pin. On the microcontroller PCB, you'll notice a circular marking indicating pin 1. Starting from this point, count to the 4th pin, which line is connected to capacitor C66 on the PCB. This is the reset pin. We'll solder the white cable to this point to establish the reset connection. Once the soldering is complete, we will carefully position the wire and attach it securely to the connector. With this final connection in place, the hardware setup is now complete. Now we will connect the ST-Link V2 programmer to the computer using its USB connector. Once the USB is connected, you will notice that the LED 1 and LED 2 on the PCB start working, even though the PCB itself is not powered by an external power source. The power is being supplied solely through the USB connection from the programmer. Additionally, the red LED on the ST-Link V2 programmer will light up, indicating that the connection is active. The first step now is to read the program from the microcontroller and save it to the computer. This step is crucial because saving the current program allows us to create a backup for future use. Once all the connections are properly made, the next step is to proceed with the software. Since the configuration is already completed, the next step is to click the Read button in the software. When you click on the Read button, you will see two options, Current tab and All tabs, on active sectors if any. Since we are currently focusing on reading the microcontroller's data, I will select the Current tab option. Upon clicking this, the microcontroller's program will be read and displayed in the software interface. You can now see the program data has been successfully retrieved. Below this data, you'll notice that all the sectors are empty, which is normal. The next step is to save this program. There are two methods to save the data, either by clicking the blue floppy drive icon or by selecting File from the top menu and then choosing Save As. I recommend using the Save As option to easily assign a custom name for the backup file. In my case, I had previously saved a program file, but to demonstrate the process again, I'll save it under a new name. This time I'll name it Nadim. You can name it according to your preference. After saving the file, I simply close the software. I successfully saved the microcontroller's program to my computer in the designated drive. The saved file appears as NadimS19 within the STM programming folder. However, this file cannot be opened or edited directly if for any reason, the microcontroller becomes faulty and needs to be replaced. The same software and hardware setup will be used for reprogramming. To write the saved program onto a new microcontroller, you'll need to open the previously saved file. I open the NadimS19 file, and as you can see, the entire program is now visible in the software. The next step is to write this program onto the new microcontroller. In the software, there's an option labeled Program, which offers two choices, Current tab and All tabs. Below these options, there are additional sections labeled Program Memory, Data Memory, and Option Bytes. If any existing program is present in these sections, selecting All tabs will overwrite all the data. Since my microcontroller currently has no existing program, I can select either Current tab or All tabs. Both options will work. For simplicity and completeness, I chose All tabs to ensure all data is written correctly. The software processed the command, and the entire program was successfully copied to the new microcontroller. Although the previous program was already present, I overwrote it for demonstration purposes. Typically, this process is performed when installing a new microcontroller, ensuring it is correctly programmed and functional. After programming, I noticed that LED 1 was turning on, but the green LED 2 remained off. To resolve this, I disconnected the USB cable from the ST-Link V2 and removed the programmer itself from the PCB. After reconnecting the PCB to its power supply and turning it on, both LED 1 and LED 2 illuminated, confirming the system was functioning properly. Using this method, you can efficiently read and write programs for any STM8 microcontroller, ensuring smooth restoration and replacement processes. Click on the left or right thumbnail to watch our next videos and subscribe. Thank you.